Good morning, everyone. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're just a couple of minutes away from our band of brothers live, Facebook Live, teaching this morning. Once again, I thank God for another day. Thank God for eternal life. And I thank God, our Heavenly Father, for His grace that is so sufficient. And I'm also grateful to be able to be filling in for our dear friend, our brother, and our leader, Kenny Grant. Let us make sure that we continue to keep Kenny lifted up in prayer, that God will continue to sustain him and bring him back to us in full health. I trust that God is Jehovah Rapha. He's the Lord, our healer. And so we're just grateful once again for God bringing him through his storm. Once again, I'm always so humbled and I'm appreciative to be able to share the Banner Brothers, this group of men that I love so much and hold so dear to my heart. I've been a part of the Banner Brothers now about 7 to 8 years, and the friendships and the brothers that I've been able to unite with has been awesome, and I'm grateful for each and every one of them. I'm grateful for my name is Anthony Lee Edwards. For those who may not know me, I've been blessed to pastor the wonderful people at Beulah Baptist Church now for almost 14 years here in Savannah, Georgia. But we're going to pray and we're going to get started into our word that I believe the Lord has shared on my heart. And I believe it's a fitting word for the time that we're living in. Let us pray. Father, in the gracious and wonderful name of Jesus, Lord, as once again we pause to say thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Father, we thank you for your dear son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who's made it possible for us to have eternal life. Father, we thank you for the wonderful gift and the promise of the Holy Spirit who healed us until that wonderful day of redemption. Father, we thank you once again, Lord God, for all of your provision, your protection that you continue to provide for us each and every day. We pray for our nation, we pray for our president, our vice president, all state and local officials. We lift up Kenny to you, Lord, and we just thank you for touching his body. And not only Kenny, Lord, all those, Lord God, who have been affected in some type of way, Lord, we are praying and we are just trusting you with them, Lord. Lord, grant me your grace as we share our word this morning on our band of brothers. Lord, we thank you. These and all blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the Lord has laid a word on my heart that I believe I want to share with us this morning out of Mark's Gospel, chapter 4. It is a very, very familiar story, but I believe that for the times that we're living in, it is a very right now word. Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, we're going to begin in verse 35. I want to read part of our text, and then I just want to strategically make application and give some insight into this text. Jesus has been doing a lot of training, a lot of teaching, and with teaching comes training. In other words, there will come a time that Jesus will have to give us some OJT, on-the-job training. There's times we're going to have to come out of the classroom, and what we've been instructed with, we're going to have to apply to our lives. So here in Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, starting at verse 35, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, Jesus now about to speak a word to his disciples, let us cross over to the other side. Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, the lower part of the boat, asleep on a pillow, and they awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? We're going to continue with this this chapter, but that's the familiar response that most of us, when storms begin to come in our lives, one of the first responses, we begin to ask that question, Lord, do you care? But as we're looking at this text, I just want to give us kind of a topic that we could tuck away in our hearts as we're going to just move through Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 39. It's called weathering your storm, weathering your storm. This is a personal thing. In all of our lives, as we're going to see, just like with these disciples, in all of our lives, out of nowhere, there will arise storms. There will arise those uncomfortable situations. There will arise those situations in our life that we didn't solicit Jesus to bring into our lives. But the key to it, we can, by God's grace and God's mercy, weather our storm. What does it mean to weather your storm? This is the definition of weathering your storm. It just simply means this: to reach the end of a very difficult situation. That's the definition of weathering a storm. To reach the end of a very difficult situation. As we're going to see, even though the storm has arisen in these disciples' lives, there's going to come a time that they're going to reach the end of the storm, that they will have weathered their storm. And I just want to encourage those of us who are watching this banner, brothers, this morning. There are those who are going through personal storms. Our nation is raging with storms, but we as children of God, we can weather our storms if we approach our storms the proper way. One thing we got to realize about storms, number one, as we're going to see with this particular storm in the text, storms at times will appear to be unbearable. You know, we ask the Lord, Lord, why have you allowed this great weight on my life? Why have you allowed this weight, this pain to come in my family? Yes, there will be times, as in our text, storms will appear to be unbearable. But also, this is a unique thing about storms. Storms will be that uncontrollable thing in our lives. Get that now. Now, at times, storms would appear to be unbearable. But then storms will be those things in our lives that are uncontrollable. Let me push it right now. A storm will be that thing in our lives. At this time, we can't write a check to fix it. Get that now. We don't have enough bank to fix it. We don't have enough brain to fix it. We don't have enough bronze to fix it. So yeah, there will be storms in our lives that are unbearable, but then there will be storms in our lives that are uncontrollable. There is nothing we can do to fix it. But one thing I love about this text, and I love about the God that we serve, those storms are unbearable. Those storms are uncontrollable. I thank God that Jesus can do the unimaginable. Yes, he can. When we least expect it, Jesus can do that thing in our lives that blows our mind and deal with the storm that we're facing. Now, I'm a 70s kid, and when I was growing up, we used to come home from school, and there was some wonderful, wonderful, good, clean sitcoms, and every day we would get out of school, get settled in, and on the TV, there was a TV sitcom that came on. We talk about weathering your storm. And one of the sitcoms that would come on when I get home from school and come on TV, I think around 4 o'clock, was Gilligan's Island. I know some of y'all, you know, old timers remember that. Gilligan's Island. I used to love the theme song to Gilligan's Island. I put it down because I wanted to say it just like the theme song. We're talking about weathering our storm. Gilligan's Island. And this is what the theme song said. And I used to love when Gilligan Island used to come on and that theme song came on. It said, just sit right back and you'll hear a tale of a fateful trip. Now get this now. That started from this tropic port aboard a tiny ship. The mate was mighty sailor man, the skipper brave and sure. Get this now. 5 passengers set sail that day for a 3-hour tour. A 3-hour tour. The weather started getting rough. The tiny ship was tossed. If not for the courage of the fearless crew, the minnow would be lost. Now get that now. They started out on a little 3-hour tour that day on Gilligan's Island. And we knew that Gilligan and Skipper and all the Ginger, all of those, Mr. Howe, was shipwrecked for years on an island because of a storm. That's the unique things about storms. Storms have a way of impacting all of us in different ways. That's why we talk about weathering our storm, because there are some men, some brothers that when a storm comes in their life, it takes them years to recover. And then other brothers who put their trust, put their faith in God's grace and God's mercy, they're able to weather their storm. But this said that if it was not for a fearless crew, but we're not dependent on a fearless crew in our storm. We're dependent on a faithful Christ. We're dependent upon Jesus himself. He's the only one that can help us through our storms, as we're going to see here in Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 35 through 39. But before we get in our text, I also want to say something else. It's amazing in our natural life. We are in a storm season. We're on the East Coast and hurricanes. We just had a storm that just grazed our coast. We thank God for his mercy once again. And the main thing about surviving a storm is having a plan in place. That's the first thing when this type of season comes in our life, hurricane season. They talk about making sure you're having a plan. And when it comes to physical storms, I know I got some good brothers. When it comes to physical storms, we make sure our generators, we got our Generac system, you know, up to date. We have our water. We have our canned goods stored up. And it's amazing with physical storms, we take all of the necessary time, we take all of the necessary treasure to prepare for the physical storms of life. But I want to ask this probing question, but do we do likewise for our spiritual storms? Now, one thing you got to realize about a physical storms, they can be unbearable and they could be uncontrollable. Let me tell you another thing, our storms can be unforeseeable. Yes, once again, just like Gilligan Island theme song, they started out for a 3-hour tour. And even though we're having this lesson early this morning at 6:30, before today ends, before we end our day, somebody can experience a storm that was unforeseeable. So yes, we prepare for our natural storms. We do all of the necessary things to prepare for our natural storms. But brothers, are we doing likewise for the spiritual storms of life? Because once again, they are coming. Whether you request it or not, they are coming to all of our lives. As we see with our own brother, our own dear friend, our leader, Kenny. Out of nowhere, boom, a storm has hit him. And that's likewise with us. Remember, a storm is going to be unforeseeable. A storm is going to be unbearable. A storm will be uncontrollable. You can't write a check to get the storm away from you. Only thing we're going to have to do is bunker down. We're going to have to bunker down and trust the Lord Jesus Christ to bring us through the storm. Just like we prepare for our physical storms, I believe through our text, there's a way we can prepare for our spiritual storms. How can we prepare for our spiritual storms that will arise in our lives? As we look back at our text here in Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, number one, this is how we prepare for our spiritual storms. Number one, get this now, understand his providence. Understand his providence. Let's look back at the text. Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 35. On the same day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us cross over to the other side." Now, for those, and I pray that those who are tuning in, we do know that Jesus is omniscient. He's all-knowing. He is divine. He is divinity and humanity. He's not half man and half God. He's fully God and fully man. Jesus understood what was going to confront those disciples on that water that day. He knew that. So once again, in order to weather our storms, understand number one, his providence. Remember now, Jesus has been doing some teaching with his disciples, but now he must put them through training. Let me push it. You can't sit in orientation for the rest of your life. You can't sit. No, you got to get out there and get to work. So now the disciples are about to get some real OJT, on-the-job training. But in order to weather our storm, number one, we got to understand that God is providential. It's God's providence. When I think about providence and I think about storms, I think about two individuals right away, because Jesus was leading them into the storm. I think about, number one, that old patriarch, that old faithful one, Job. Job had a providential storm. Here's one day, Satan appears out of nowhere, going to and fro in the earth. And the funny thing about it, God put the question out there, have you considered my servant Job? And the devil, you know, begins to dialogue with God. You know, I can't do nothing to him because you have a hedge around him. In other words, this would be a providential storm. What the devil was trying to say, God, Job only serving you because you give him all those things. And God wanted to show the devil, Job served me because he loved me. But this was a providential storm. Then we think about old Joseph, that young 17-year-old teenager. Genesis chapter 37. God gave Joseph a dream that one day his brother was going to bow to him. But God didn't tell Joseph all of the storms that were going to rage in his life. And I believe, this is what I personally believe, I believe that the reason Joseph was able to survive the pit, you know, think about this. He received treason from his own brothers. They sold him into slavery. They threw him into the pit. He got out of the pit, made progress after the pit. Then there was the preparation in the prison. He went through the prison. I believe that the only thing Joseph could hold on to was this. God gave me a dream that one day my brothers were going to bow to me. This is how Joseph weathered his storm. He understood providence. Remember, he was telling his brothers at the end, y'all sold me, but God was sending me. Get this now. He understood this. This was providence. And we have to understand there will be storms in our lives, that this is providence. God is allowing these storms to make us into the image of his dear son, Jesus Christ. But Joseph, when he was thrown in that pit, I guarantee Joseph said, well, my brothers hadn't bowed to me yet, so this couldn't be the end. They got him out of the pit. He got down there in Egypt. He got thrown into their prison. I guess Joseph said, you know what? My brothers hadn't bowed to me yet. I guess this ain't the end. See, when you have God's word, you have God's assurity. And because his brothers had not bowed to him yet, Joseph could understand this was a providential storm. So here in Mark 4, verse 35, if we're going to weather our storms, understand providence. On the same day when the evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now, when they had left the multitude, they had took him along in the boat as he was. So number one, understand God's providence. But I also realize this. Another thing we need in order to weather our storm is this: understanding God's promise. Understanding God's promise. Now, once we understand God's providence, we also have to understand God's promise. What was the promise that the Lord Jesus Christ gave his disciples? Verse 35 of Mark 4, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us stop. If Jesus said, let us cross over to the other side, it doesn't matter what comes up between that point and the other side. If Jesus says, let us cross over to the other side, guess what? You going to the other side. And brothers, I just want to talk to us this morning, because too often when storms begin to come in our lives and life begin to rage, we begin to take our focus off of the promises of God. He that promised is faithful. Remember what I just said about Joseph. Joseph had the promise that one day his brothers were going to bow to him. And it didn't matter what happened until his brothers bowed to him. Nothing could happen to his life. And I believe that when storms begin to rage in our life, we forget about the promises of God. And God has promised, brothers, never to leave us nor forsake us. He told the disciples, let us go to the other side. What I love what the text goes on to say this in verse 36 of Mark 4. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. And other little boats were also with them. Can I push it right here? Now, many times we just focus on the disciples and Jesus in their boat, but there were other little boats around them. Get this now. How we weather our storm can mean the difference between other people weathering their storms or not. Get that nugget. Once the disciples come through their storm and weather their storm because of Jesus, we have our children looking at us. We have our spouses looking at us. We have our co-workers looking at us. We have the neighbors in the community looking at us. And in all these storms that's going on in our world today, people, let me use, folks are looking at us. And when we are fainting, giving up, and caving in, and we proclaim to be believers and trusters and trusting in Jesus Christ, and other people from a distance are watching us, and we acting like the world, and let me go ahead and push it right now since we on this Facebook Live. On our post, we acting like the world, and people sitting there looking, saying, wow, one minute he put a scripture about Jesus, and now look what he posted just now. I just pushed it just now. And see, we got to be mindful that how we weather our storm can mean the difference of how other people weather their storms. My wife and I was watching the movie last night, and old Captain Phillips, and how Captain Phillips, when they were those pirates, Jack that tried to jack the Alabama, but I noticed through it all, Captain Phillips remained calm as the captain. He didn't waver. He kept his crew at peace because he was willing to weather his storm. And I'm telling you, brothers, we got to make sure that we keep our eyes on the promise of God, because other people are looking at us. Other people are depending on us. And when a world who are full of sinners and the people that are lost and they need hope, and then we're acting like them, how can they weather their storm if we're not weathering ours? So number one, listen, understand God's providence. Number two, understand his promise. But number three, if we're going to weather our storm, understand his providence, understand his promise, but now understand his presence. Brothers, do we know who lives within our hearts? If you truly born again, the Spirit of God dwells in your hearts. Let's look at the text once again. On the same day, verse 35 of Mark 4, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. They have the promise. Now, watch this. They also have the Lord's presence. And other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling, but he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And let's be honest, we all flesh and blood, and many times when those storms get to raging in our life, and that's the first thing we begin to think, the Lord doesn't care. You know, I can imagine Martha and Mary, when the Lord did not come in the time they wanted him to come, they begin to say, the Lord doesn't care. But if I ever have any doubt whether the Lord Jesus Christ really cares about us or not, just look at Calvary. Just look at Calvary. And you may be going through a storm right now, and it appears that the Lord is not coming when you want him to come. And you beginning to doubt, does the Lord love you? Look at Calvary. Calvary speaks loud, and Calvary speaks clear that Jesus loves us. But the reason they could weather the storm is because of his providence, his promise, but now his presence is right there with him. Brothers, don't forget, when we're looking in all these places, look in our hearts. There lies the very presence of our God. I'm grateful that greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. They had Jesus with them in the boat. They had nothing to worry about. We have the Lord Jesus Christ right here in the person of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. We have his presence with us. We have the better covenant. We have the new covenant. We are children of God, marked, sealed with the Holy Spirit. And last but not least, understand his providence if you're going to weather your storm. Understand his promise. He said, let us go to the other side. They were going to the other side no matter what. Understand his presence. Jesus was right there with them in the boat. And last and final, understand his peace. Jesus has peace for our storm. Verse 39, then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. Now, peace is not the absence of trouble. No, peace is calmness in the midst of the trouble. And I want to go back to the time that we're living in right now. Peace is not the absence of trouble. Peace is calmness in the midst of trouble. That's why Paul wrote to the believers at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. Y'all know that famous text, Philippians chapter 4, verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. The peace of God is like, now this is above my pay grade, and I don't want to infringe in an area I don't have absolutely no experience, but this is a soldier on guard duty. That soldier takes an oath. I'm going to protect this area. And that's the idea of the peace there. The peace of God that's in our heart, it protects. It keeps out all intruders. When depression tries to come and worry tries to come, and the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus. It will keep out any intruders that should not be there. Jesus was in the boat with them. His presence and his peace. He steps up and he says, peace, be still. John 16 and 33, Jesus said this, my peace I give to you. My peace I give to you. If Jesus has given us his peace, why are we allowing this stuff with Democrat and Republican? Why are we allowing this stuff in the world with masks and all this junk, as believers, to take our peace? If Jesus gave it to us, he said, now in this world, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. If we're going to weather our storm, I encourage you, have your spiritual storm kit ready. Understanding his providence, understanding his promise, understanding his presence, and last, understand his peace. Let us pray. Father, in the gracious and wonderful name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your word. And Lord, like the disciples, storms can be unforeseeable. Storms can be unbearable. Storms can be uncontrollable. But Lord Jesus, we believe that you can do the unimaginable. Father, I pray right now, like those other little boats who are out there on the water with Jesus and the disciples, there are other people watching us, how we weather our storms. And it's time for us as the body of Christ to not just be proclaimers of your word, but it's time for us to rise up through the power of the Holy Spirit and put into practice your word. Father, I pray in these times that your church will arise out of the muck and be who we've been called to be. We've been called to be salt. We've been called to be light. And it's time for us to be who we say we are. Thank you once again. Thank you for being there for our leader, our brother, our friend Kenny. Thank you for bringing him back to us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a fruitful Friday.
Just imperfect man, a broken host of sinners, made whole again. I praise you for your mercy, thank you for your grace. Abandoned brother, meet us in this place. We're abandoned brother. Just imperfect men, a broken host of sinners, made whole again. We praise you for your mercy, thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers, lead us in this place.